Thanks, everyone. Welcome to the final edition of Good News Week for 1996. And the big news, the absolutely extraordinary news that shook every man, woman, and child to the very core of their being this week, dead cats. Environmentalist Dr. John Wamsley says we could solve Australia's feral cat problem by eating them. The possibilities are endless. I mean, bake, grill, stir fry. And when the kids go to school, mum could just pop a kitten into their lunchbox. In Canberra, the federal government had to make 181 amendments to its industrial relations bill this week before the Democrats finally agreed to pass it through the Senate. In particular, Cheryl Curnow insisted on a new clause to ban dangerous and unpleasant workplace agreements, like being shut up in a room with Peter Reith. This new agreement gives many employees new freedom of choice. They can opt out of the current award system. Well, they can opt out of a job. In London, a school teacher phoned police after watching 9-year-olds passing around a packet of powdered milk during a game they called Junkies and Dealers. Apparently, the powdered milk had a street value of 3 basketball cards and a yo-yo. The teacher's worst fears were confirmed when the children were told if they didn't stop the game right now, they'd get a little smack. And they all cheered. Iran has announced plans to produce a range of dolls to protect its children from the so-called Barbie culture of the West. But why to go to all the trouble, you know, of making a new doll? If they want a toy that reflects true Iranian fashion, just stick a handkerchief over a banana. Anyway, Iran's new ideas for dolls include the mighty Muslim Power Rangers, the Cabbage Patch Kurds, and Islamic Ken, which is the same as Western Ken, except it comes with an explanation of which sin led to the loss of his, tragedy. Tragedy this week, ladies and gentlemen, with the announcement that Channel 7 has axed Gladiators. In its 2 years on air, Gladiators was scandalized by allegations of drug use and sexual misconduct. So most of them are hoping to get jobs in the police force. Greenpeace launched a surprise raid on the Sydney Olympic site at Homebush last week, digging up dozens of toxic PVC pipes. The New South Wales government was surprised at how quickly the activists got in and dug up the pipes. So now they want Greenpeace to do all the Olympic plumbing and excavation work. But if Greenpeace really wants, you know, to get rid of a toxic Olympic embarrassment, maybe they should think about blowing up Arthur Tunstall. And that's the good news. It's good news, me. Someone's rocking on some air contaminated atmosphere and dragging in the sky. It's good news, me. Someone's found a way to get the rotting dead away. Thank you, good evening, and joining me at the funny coloured desk tonight, we have the lovely Mikey Robbins, the enchanting Helen Razor, and the radiant Adam Spencer. And they're getting down to business with the alluring Julie McCrossan, the shapely Peter Burner, and the exquisite Amanda Keller. Hey, it's going to be fun. Let's get on with it then, Mikey, Helen, Adam, what is the story?
Nice. That's that silly man.
Nice man.
There's
people
another
walk,
silly
people
man.
Walking out of room.
That's a silly man leaving. Again. That's I forget his name. Let's call him Goose.
Okay.
Mr. Goose.
Mayor Goose.
Lord Mayor Goose of
Mr. Knobhead Goose.
Mr. Knobhead Goose. Yes. From Port Lincoln, who came out and in this wonderful new racially tolerant Australia that we've all woken up in. And announced that people from mixed racial backgrounds are, by dictionary definition, my friends?
Mongrels.
Mongrels.
What he said was, look, that's just a word in the English language. If you were born out of wedlock, you're a bastard, and I'll call you a bastard. If you were born of mixed race, you are a mongrel, I'll call you a mongrel. And I say, if you are a knobhead, I'll call you a knobhead.
Two marvellous, well-earned points for you there, but... I'll give you a bonus point if you can sing the mayor's favourite song, White Christmas.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas
with pointy hats and jackboots for all.
I'm going to give you 3 big points and leave it there. Yes, the mayor of Port Lincoln, sometimes called Mobbin, otherwise known as Peter Davis, has been branded unfit to hold public office after he said children from interracial marriages were mongrels. The mayor is trying to protect his racial purity, but the real threat to the continued existence of people like Davis isn't crossbreeding. It's that many of them have a problem finding their own genitals. Oh, look, there they are now. Julie, Peter, Amanda, some red hot news for you.
An aeroplane?
Oh, like an aeroplane there.
Mm-hmm. Contraband?
An arms cache.
Rather tall building. Something not recommended for small children. Gorgeous island.
And an island.
Oh, and a pine, Norfolk pine.
It's a party at Bill O'Cheese place.
This is a story that made the whole nation wonder just how many people on Norfolk Island smoke. Would that be correct?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. They would take cigarettes out of Australia that they'd bought to Norfolk Island that would get a tax stamp. And then they would take an overnight holiday at another local island, come back and bring them back with a federal tax stamp on them, and then flog them.
So basically they made a hell of a lot of money out of flying cigarettes off onto an island and off again.
And it took them. This is the classic thing. They came on and said, who do these idiots think they are that we weren't going to twig to this? How long? 7 years.
To make it 3 points, sing Fly Me to the Moon.
Fly me to the moon, and let me play among the stars.
That's fantastic.
Who's the glove puppet in the middle?
It's the ugly pointer sister, that one.
Wayne Pointer.
Federal Customs thought 4 million cigarettes seemed an awful lot of tobacco to be flying out of Norfolk Island. Well, considering it has a population of only 2,000 people.
Common sense would suggest that the residents of Norfolk Island couldn't consume that amount of tobacco.
Common sense.
The tobacco companies asked that the smugglers be treated with leniency because it's not like smuggling a few cigarettes is going to kill anyone. Okay, let's do the strange but true thing one more time. Before the show, both teams were given 3 clues to a recent weird and wonderful tale. Robbins, Razor and Spencer got a rabbit, a dead one at that.
My pajamas are in that, be careful.
Liberation Organization and Primary Industries Minister John Anderson.
Look, boys and girls, it's having a drink.
I'm all right to drive.
That's a disease rabbit.
You could work with the Wiggles with that, eh?
Macross and Burner and Keller received a can of spray paint, a key to the executive washroom.
But Peter's broken.
I broke.
And Thomas the tank engine.
Oh. JFK Jr.'s wedding presents, I reckon.
But before we get to those fun stories, round two, starting with Perfect Match. Mikey, we're looking for the ideal partner for Gene Simmons of Kiss.
He's just eating the rabbit.
Yeah. To choose from, we have Woody Allen.
Very big nosebleed.
Iggy Pop and Jesus of Nazareth. Who is Gene's perfect match?
Jesus looks like he's crowd diving or something.
Yeah. Jesus was saying, I once caught a fish this big.
Speaking of crowd surfing, this bloke and I once noticed at the big day out that Iggy is actually uncircumcised, which is odd considering his denomination. So I mean, everybody else would
and
be,
he's
I guess.
For razor blades.
Actually, you're on the right track here. Gene came out during the week in a press statement and said that he was probably one of the most popular Jewish men of all time. He's never met Netanyahu, of course. So, as such, he compared himself with Jesus. He said that he and Jesus were similar because that millions of people followed them and worshipped them, and they both hung around with Paul Stanley. So, I'd say it's Gene and Jesus all the way.
Jesus was a great bass guitarist.
He was. You ever heard Jesus doing, I was made for loving you, Father. You were made for loving me.
Let's just see if you're right. The perfect match is Jesus. 1 point. It is Jesus, and it is indeed a worship thing. Gene is Jewish and says he can't see why he shouldn't be worshipped too. Sounds like a great idea. Anyone else want to help me with the nails? Although, when you think about it, Kiss have sold millions of albums, but Jesus only moved one unit of heavy rock in his life. A religion based on the life of Gene would be a little different, though. For a start, the Ten Commandments would have to be whittled down to eight, dropping the really hard ones about adultery and your neighbour's wife.
So does that mean your neighbour's ass is still in there? No, probably not.
Okay, Julie, big time for you now. Find a special friend for our Prime Minister.
Oh,
your suitors are?
He's been with the rabbit as well.
your suitors are Tim Fisher. We have Rodney... Rodney King.
Oh, yes.
And Pinocchio.
Oh, dear.
Who's John's perfect match?
Well, look, obviously race has been a big issue, and Fisher and John could be together in the sense that they both have spoken out against Pauline Hanson, but only in relation to the Asian economy. But I guess the thing that this week is particularly in my head is those shots of Howard at Sydney University. I don't know if you saw it getting thumped around in a way that might get his security men caned. Makes me think of the video footage of Rodney King. So perhaps both, they're a perfect match because they've both been battered in a public way, captured on film.
Very good.
King Howard.
Actually battered. Now, Pauline Hanson could do that well.
I'm saying Rodney King.
Okay, let's see it.
No!
Rodney King, let's hear it. It's Rodney King. They've both been known to cause a riot. Howard was jostled and abused in a violent protest in Sydney, at Sydney University last weekend. The Prime Minister said during the riot his life actually flashed before his eyes, and amazingly, he managed to stay awake during the whole thing. Game two, round two is bites. Helen, some words of wisdom from that eminent person, Malcolm Fraser.
When you think it's all going your way, that's the very time when something sneaks up behind you and you find it hasn't.
Talking about boarding school?
Losing his trousers in Houston?
I think there's a trio of significant possibilities. The very beautiful drag queen who was photographed with some time ago in Chicago, possibly the pants incident, but Malcolm has been most recently in the news in his capacity as special envoy to Africa and the UN. Australia were supposed to be part of the UN Security Council. Somehow Portugal pipped him at the post. They thought they had hundreds of votes. Only got
two words here: Alexander Downer.
Another two words, Peter Costello. I mean,
it scares him.
1 point.
Can I just say, some of us old enough to remember when he cried on telly the last time when he lost power. Just
not. Did that affect you when it happened?
Well, funnily enough, you know, it was the first time I'd seen one of our leaders sob on telly. It became commonplace in the 80s, but in the 70s it was unusual.
It was unusual. Yes, John Howard has ordered an inquiry into Australia's embarrassing failure to get a seat on the UN Security Council. I think it was a mistake to let Alexander Downer ask for votes by saying to people, be your best friend if you do. Being a member of the Security Council, I mean, that would have been so good. You get to sit around a table with the great world powers, you know, and have your interests ignored face to face. Peter, what's got Jacques Chirac hot under the collar here?
Oh, Jacques Chirac, ah. Oh, get away, you fair man, you. No, I don't know the recipe for croissant.
Then let them go.
Go away.
It's more crowd jostling. It's a night of crowd jostling.
No, I do not know Peter Sellers, and I've never seen the Pink Panther movie.
I was a room for my monkey.
What is this? I do not know the recipe. Go away. I use electric, not gas. It's all about, he's in Israel on the left bank or the right bank, whichever bank is the notorious bank to be on.
I think it's West.
The West Bank, yes. The West Bank.
Which bank?
He looked like he just missed out on tickets for some Oasis gig in Israel or something. Very pissed off.
He's being jostled by, and he's telling the Israeli security forces to let him speak to the Palestinians, because that's what he was there for. Netanyahu, you invited me here to get to know your culture, or to get to know your culture, and as he was saying, and he was very upset that he was not allowed to just mingle with the people.
1 point! Well, the French president was furious when Israeli security police refused to let him meet Palestinian residents in Jerusalem last week. Chirac said that people who thought they were suffering violence from an occupying power had the right to approach him. I mean, it's not as if they're Polynesians. The president actually said he first knew the Israelis were overreacting when someone held up a baby for him to kiss and a guard knocked it to the ground and fell on it. Well, he finished the one-on-one round with Spot the Bull. Adam, the federal government recently lifted its ban on uranium sales to France. What did acting foreign minister Tim Fischer have to say about it? Did he say nuclear power is greatly helping the world's environment? More widespread use of atomic energy will help reduce Europe's acid rain problem? Or did he say France signed the non-proliferation treaty? To say we're helping them proliferate is a nonsense.
I've played this game before, Paul, and I've done this section of the show, and the key here, viewers, if you ever get on this show, is you've got to put yourself in the mind of the person who's making the quote. And which of these quotes is most likely for them?
Well, I mean that's easy, because there's plenty of space to get in there.
Exactly. The important thing here is, I think, we start to look at these and say, are any of them too intelligent for Tim to have said?
Okay? Well, I mean, the word greatly is a worry.
Yeah, I'm more worried about Europe's acid rain problem. No chance Tim would ever have heard about that. And if you look at the third one, he says, we're helping them proliferate is a nonsense, which is good, correct grammar. Not likely with Tim. Number one. Absolutely number one.
Okay, you're really sure about that?
We say one or three.
Okay, what are we going with? As a team and a rabbit, what are we going with?
We're behind Adam.
We're going number one.
Oh, okay, right. Let's see what Timmy said.
Nuclear power is greatly helping the world environment.
How does he do it, eh? How does he do it? I mean, just weeks ago, Tim Fischer was telling us that the Chinese have improved life in Tibet. And now he's an expert on nuclear power being good for the environment. Stand by for Tim's views on why being hit by a bus helps the local car industry and how having cancer actually improves your overall fitness. But as Fischer says, uranium mining gets rid of all that nasty radioactive rock and sends it over to France. I mean, Tim isn't sure what they do with it, but it can't possibly affect us here in the South Pacific. I mean, can it? There's no way. You'd need a plane or something to fly it up. Amanda now, Liberal MP Richard Evans wants to eradicate all cats by the year 2020.
He's got two on his forehead.
What does Andrew Lloyd Webb have to say about that?
It's going to come soon enough.
Okay, which of these statements is his? Did he say, we cannot let this genocide continue? It is genocide, Helen. Make no bones about that. Did he say, what do you call 3 million sterilized cats? A damn good start. Or did he say, does a cat kill? Yes, it does. Does it kill native fauna? Yes, it does. Do we want this to happen? No, we don't.
I think it was number one. We cannot let this genocide continue. And it is genocide, Helen, whoever Helen is.
Helen, that's a copless SBS. Like to give him a plug.
That's right. Helen Demidenko, perhaps it was her. I think... What
it
do
was
you
Helen
think,
Keller, and he was shouting.
That's right. I'm with you.
You think number
because
one?
Because you're wearing a cat.
Well, exactly. I'm wearing a cat. I'm channeling a cat. I'm saying number one.
I've channeled a cat.
You're going for number one.
We're going for number one.
Because it is the last show and because I'm such a magnanimous human being, would you care to have another stab at it?
There's a rhythm to number three that makes me think he may have had media training. Ask a question, answer it. Ask a question, answer it.
All right, let's go number three.
Okay,
number three,
you're going number three. Let's see what he said.
Does a cat kill? Yes, it does. Does it kill native fauna? Yes, it does. Do we want this to happen? No, we don't.
Evan says there should be a mass sterilization of Australia's 3 million cats. But there are other eradication suggestions. These include hooking the cats up to euthanasia machines and telling them if they push yes three times, they get a fish. And instead of using Garfields, just super gluing the paws of real cats onto car windows. Adam, Helen, Mikey, who's the odd one out here?
Okay.
We have bananas in pyjamas.
That was them at Mardi Gras. Mm.
John Howard.
At Mardi Gras. In the Navy.
A piece of Australian cheese. And Prince Charles.
That's Prince Charles watching the Mardi Gras. Mm. Now, you can't serve bananas to the royal family. Honestly, this is true. If you ever throw a dinner party for any of the royals, and God knows it's a fair chance most of us will, apparently the banana is too phallic for a royal, even the Queen Mother, who is actually scared of them. Now, there was the big dinner for Di last night. Now, the bananas couldn't have been there because, I'm not talking B1, B2, but bananas in general. You can't give the royal family bananas because they're a little phallic and they go, oh, phallic, and they run away. John Howard couldn't go because he's shorter than Ray Martin. I'm a bit peeved about that. And he's, I don't like that, but his hat was stuck to his head. So
and there's something phallic in his picture as well, so he couldn't go.
And Prince Charles couldn't go because they got divorced and they're not happy anymore. But apparently Australian cheese was on the dessert list because it's, well, as Di says, it's damn easy to throw up. She loves it. Australian cheese was the only thing that was at dinner with Di last night.
2 points! Yeah.
Of course, royals should never be served bananas. They're too strongly associated with republics.
Jippy!
Yes! And there's a light, no. Everything about it is appealing.
Amanda, Peter, Julie, who's the band-aid in the coleslaw here? We have Danny Bonaducci, wow. Helen Demidenko, no. Charles Manson, and Amanda Vanston. There she is.
I reckon it's something to do with families.
I don't know which would be a worse family, actually. What do you think of? Maybe it's...
Well, maybe the Partridge Family guy, in the end, with the other three, is the only family you'd want to go to reunion with. Maybe...
Well, that's true.
It's all got to do. The odd one out is, the odd one out is Charlie Manson.
You reckon? Well, yeah. Why is that?
Because he has a real family.
Well, I think I'm with you, Julie. I think that's the only family reunion you wouldn't want to go to. Imagine going to a family reunion.
Okay, so you're saying Danny Bonaducci and you're saying Charlie?
Let's split the difference and go Amanda.
Little piggies,
Vanstone.
Little piggies. Help the skeleton, little piggies.
I would be going in that direction if I was you.
Yeah, he's the only one. Charles Mann's the only one with an amusing tattoo.
I'm going to give you a...
Hey, you haven't seen Amanda Vanstone in the shower.
And you have.
I get around.
Must be a very big shower.
I'm going to give you one...
Well, they had to get 2 cans of Pure and Simple to get us out.
I'm going to recover myself.
We're saying Charlie Manson's got, you know, a real...
He got the goods. I'm going to give you 1 point for that because I've never had to lead any team as much as I had to lead you towards Charlie Manson. So only 1 point. It is Charlie Manson. His family actually existed. Amanda Vanstone has admitted she misled Parliament after using an imaginary family on welfare to justify cuts to Austerity. The irony is Amanda's family pretends she doesn't exist. Face value is the name of the game. Amanda, for 4 points, who lurks behind this rather clever disguise?
Oh, wow. No, I'd have to say Graham Bond.
No.
It's not Kim Beazley.
Kim Beazley.
It's Kim Beazley.
Is it Kim Beazley?
We're going for Kim Beazley. We're pushing Kim Beazley. Oh, yeah.
Win the head! Yes! Thank you!
It is Kim Beazley!
Of course it's Kim Beazley. Ruined the game for everyone, Julie McGrossen. Let's take away the rest of the disguise there. I'm sorry I'm not thinking properly at the moment because my brain's over here as well. Yes, a recent news poll shows support for Labor has slumped to its lowest level in 7 months. That's even lower than its result in the March federal election. Beazley says he hasn't had time to look at the polls. He's too busy getting ready to play Santa at the Parliament House Christmas party. And Bronwyn Bishop is going to make one hell of a nutcracker. So it all comes down to the final round of Strange But True. Mikey, Helen, Adam, your clues were the rabbit, animal liberation, and John Anderson.
Yes, well, I think it's got something to do with Khaleesi virus. Uh-huh. Although this rabbit actually has Campisi virus.
Now that the bunny's finished playing his 100th test. I guess Animal Liberation's objections to the Khaleesi virus because the animals would die in pain.
There was a beautiful bit during the week when this lovely gentleman said it's absolutely safe, this Khaleesi virus, there's nothing to worry about, it's so safe, I would let my daughter be injected with it. And it follows on the long tradition of politicians like John Major said, look, man-cow disease, no trouble at all, I'd let my son eat one of the burgers, etc. And these guys are very hesitant to say, oh, I'll touch it. No, not me.
OK, I'm going to give you a big 4 points for that. Of course, John Anderson can't just take the virus himself. If they're going to do it properly, they'll have to dose up a couple of his friends and release them in his house. Julie, Peter, Amanda, your story has something to do with spray paint, the executive washroom key, and silly old Thomas the Tank Engine.
OK, this is one of those stories about which you either rejoice at the nature of the public service or despair, depending on your perspective. Essentially, we have an employee...
An employee of the railways, I think, and someone who is working with the New South Wales Railways.
Gets a can...
Which is an oxymoron.
Don't call me that.
Gets a can before, I think, a new train or a dolled-up clean train.
A train that's about to leave the warehouse.
Brand new.
To the track.
Essentially, he graffitis the train, and the executive washroom key, is because, believe it or not, this guy is discovered to have graffitied a train as an employee of State Rail, and he not only keeps his job, he is promoted.
And now, the only reason he got in trouble was because he went outside the lines when he was spraying.
if you believe that graffiti is a creative personal expression, you like the story, but if you think perhaps employees shouldn't graffiti the trains, maybe you're not so happy.
You are right. After pleading guilty to a 15-month graffiti rampage, a New South Wales State Rail worker has been promoted and is still highly regarded by his employer. They gave him the promotion because they were impressed by his application. It was on carriages 1 to 5 of the 843 from Bankstown. According to his lawyer, the rail worker has now given up graffiti and has turned to more traditional art, carving his name on all the desks at head office. Mikey Robbins, Helen Razor, Adam Spencer finish with a knife, wielding 12 points. Champions tonight over Julie Macross and Peter Burner and Amanda Keller on a bother booted 11 points. I hate to say it, but you were robbed of that extra point by the rabbit.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Help me, there's a fat man with his hand on my genitals.
Oh, like that's something new.
I'm going to give you another point and say it's tied! So we say thank you to the hardest working teams in show business. And seeing it's the end of the series, we'd also like to take a moment to thank some of the people who've made Good News Week possible this year. I'd like to thank John Howard. Kim Beazley, Ian McNiven has been an absolute trooper.
The Royal Family.
The Royal Family.
Mandavanstone. Bananas in pyjamas.
The Olympic flag. Let's not say Pauline Hanson. Value Jet. Value Jet.
That woman who became a lesbian when the bingo sign.
Oh, I love you. My favourite.
Let's not forget little Jessica DeBroff. And I think one woman we would like to thank more than any other is Barbara Cartland!
Well, I think what I've done is I've made a great many people happy.
And so we leave you for 1996 with the good news that the New South Wales government has announced that they're going to make the Sydney 2000 Games even more environmentally friendly by surfacing the Olympic Stadium with feral cat fur. Yes, it will also supply lots of jobs for the unemployed who get to lick it clean between events. Good night. See you next year.
Thank you!